Good morning. That was hopping. I like that. That was I've been reminiscing about my own mom today. You know, if you're watching, you probably are, but my mom, thank you, Mom. Happy Mom's Day. My mother is an awesome and caring person, and I have learned so much from my entire life. You see, when I was a child, our household was pretty much a agnostic home. It wasn't necessarily a church going home until I became older. And actually, my mom rediscovered her faith right around the same time that I discovered my faith. And so, in a lot of ways, my mom was an example for me, and someone to bounce ideas off of and bounce experiences off of as we were coming to terms with who Jesus was for the first time in my life and returning to Jesus in her life. And a lot of that was done because of a foundation coming from her mother, my grandmother, who I referred to as Nani, and I will still refer to as Nani, even though I'm a 40-year-old man who is independent. She's my Nani. But Nani had sort of this tangible faith, and through every struggle in life, and boy, did she face struggles, to see this outpouring of love and grace and faith, and relying on the rock-solid foundation of Christ, became such a beacon to our family. We didn't know it when we were younger, but as we became older and rediscovered our faith, oh my goodness, that legacy of faith became the foundation that my mom instilled in us kids as we grew older, and then us kids, as we're all raising families now, have tried to instill in our families as well. In fact, if you're ever over at our house, the piano we have in my kind of workroom is actually the piano that comes from my grandmother, from my Nani. And actually, it was in her house, and it was a gift from the person that first witnessed to her about Jesus. And so that piano kind of symbolizes the legacy of faith in my family, and right now it's sitting in my house. So moms, deep respect for you. deep respect for you. Not only would none of us be here without you, which is obvious, but also many of us wouldn't be here in this space right now without you as well. Your lives are an amazing offering and an amazing gift to those that you've come to influence. So thank you and happy Mother's Day. So hey guys, we've been in this series that we're calling Church in the Wild. And in this series, we try to take a look at what it looks like to live the Christian life in our modern, busy, 9-to-5 world. What does being a Jesus follower look in real life? What should the church, the Jesus community, look like in the wild? You know, like you figure like David Attenborough narrating, like, and here you see, I can't do the accent. And here you see the Christian loving his neighbor. That's what we're looking at. What does the Christian, what does the Jesus community look like in the midst of our modern day? 2 weeks ago, we talked about setting time aside for God, keeping the Sabbath, worship, why we gather as a community to worship and follow Jesus, why we encourage one another. Last week, Jed brought an awesome sermon about how we can love our neighbor and what that actually looks like in our day-to-day life. This week, today, I want to talk to you about what it looks like to truly embrace the purpose, the goals, the work that God has set out for us to do. Today I want to talk about what heartfelt investment into the kingdom actually looks like. Now I want to pause for a second, because in our world today, you can't say the word investment without some hackles going up. Because in our world today, the word invest or to invest in something has some pretty direct connotations. Maybe you hear the word investment and you get the image of a bunch of like Wall Street bros talking about their stock portfolios and comparing dividends. Or maybe it conjures up memories of that one time that you were forced to sit through an agonizing 4-hour timeshare meeting for your vacation in Orlando. Or an awkward conversation you've had with a family member about their new business. In our modern world, the term investment always seems to be about money. And so many of us immediately hear that and put up our defenses. Now, investment is about money, but it's also about more than that. In reality, to invest in something is to align yourself with it, to sacrifice and risk something of yourself in order to be a part of a joined effort. To invest is to put skin in the game, to join the cause, to commit to being part of the project, to commit to the well-being of the project. When what you're investing in succeeds, you share some of that success. When it fails, you share some of those losses, hence the risk. When you invest in a project, any project, whether it's a new business or an effort or whatever, you can invest your time, you can invest your money, your effort, your passion, your purpose, your identity. To be an investor in a project is to help drive that project forward. All right? On the other end of the process, on the other end of investors, you have a consumer. Now, a consumer merely uses or consumes the final product that is being created. A consumer really isn't involved in the creation process. A consumer consumes. In other words, a consumer rides the bus, an investor drives the bus. So with that being said, we have some questions we need to ask ourselves. In our world today, in our church, in our project, in our mission as Jesus followers, are we investors in the kingdom? Or are we merely consumers of church culture? That's a hard question. It's convicting in a lot of ways to myself. But really, are we risking our time, our money, our efforts to help grow the Jesus community into what it's meant to be? Or are we going through the motions and simply consuming the end product? In other words, what does it look like to actually be workers? What does it look like to drive the bus instead of merely ride on it? What does it look like to be heartfelt, honest, true, and passionate investors into the kingdom of God? So we're going to jump into scripture here. We're going to be in 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 16. Now for this verse, if you're flipping it in the Bible you have, it's going to look a little different, because for this verse, I actually prefer the ESV version, and so that's what you see up behind me. I read a whole bunch of different versions of the Bible, and I encourage you to do so as well. Read a whole bunch of different translations. The more translations you read, the better in a lot of ways, as long as they're authoritative translations. I like teaching out of the NIV. I like teaching out of the NLT, but every so often I see a translation that I like just a little better in a certain verse. And in this one, I really like the ESV version specifically. So I'm going to read it to you here. This is from the ESV. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but instead living as servants of God. Now, this takes some unpacking here a little bit. Live as people who are free. What does that mean? Well, as Jesus followers, we believe that we have freedom in Christ. That because of the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus, we have a freedom beyond understanding. We typically think of this word as of freedom as meaning free from consequences, free from guilt, or free from punishment. And while that is part of it, real, true freedom and the freedom that God offers goes beyond just the freedom from punishment. As he didn't just pardon us for our mistakes, but rather he offered us a way out of needing to make those mistakes to begin with. Because in the death and resurrection of Jesus, Not only has he paid the price for our sin, but he's also modeled a behavior in which we can walk away from sin entirely. He's modeling a new way to be human, where we are free from the corrupting force of sin and instead free to live as someone who loves like Jesus. So it's more than simply being released from punishment, but it's also freed so that you no longer need to worry about doing something worth punishing, because he's building something new in us. Okay? So the freedom we have in Christ is this true freedom. And this means that true freedom isn't simply doing what you want, but actually wanting to do what is good instead of what is destructive. It's not merely being able to skate through life without punishment, but actually being changed in a way where you are free to live in such a way where that punishment is no longer a possibility. So what does this mean? We have freedom because of Jesus. And we are meant to use that freedom. Remember, live as people who are free, not using that freedom as a cover-up for evil. So not using that freedom as saying, I can do what I want because I'm free. Not using that, but instead using it to live as a servant of God. So we are meant to use the freedom. Freedom that we have in Christ is a tool that has been given to us to use, to invest back into the mission of God. We're supposed to invest our freedom in God's ongoing plan to redeem the world that we live in, to make this world better every day, to slowly, step by step, redeem this world and bring it back to how it was before Adam and Eve ate that apple, to bring creation into right standing with God. Our job in being free is to invest that freedom into making this world beautiful, to loving our neighbors, to redeeming our neighbors, to redeeming creation, to redeeming art, to redeeming music, to going out there and embracing the created world, loving it beyond all measure, and being a reflection of Jesus into the world. Our freedom means that we are now free to love completely. And so that's what's being said in this verse, to invest your freedom to be a servant of God. We invest our freedom to live as servants of God, to follow God's example of how to interact with the world and with humanity. And how does God interact with people? He sends his son to pay the price for our sin. He dies for us. He's generous with us. He's forgiving of us. So, because we are free, free from sin, not just the punishment of sin, but free from the compulsion of sin, free from the hold of sin, free from the corruption of sin, we then use that freedom as an investment to be generous with the world, to live lives marked by the generosity first shown by God. We are asked to live lives marked by the same generosity and investment of Jesus Christ. That's why he talks about in order to live for him, you have to die to yourself. The idea of letting your agenda go and instead being a servant of God and loving your neighbor, loving your enemy, loving everyone, sacrificing on behalf of the other. We're going to talk about that here. First, we need to be generous with our lives, generous with our time. All right, you can see that in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. Now I'm back in the NIV here. Above all, love each other deeply. Because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. That one hurts. Oof. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. So we need to work for the benefit of others. That's part of the Christian life, to work for the benefit of others. Not work for the benefit of ourselves, work for the benefit of others without grumbling, which I think is just an awesome little underhanded thing that was slipped into the text. Like, you need to love everybody and you can't complain about it. I just think that's great. So you need to work for the benefit of others without grumbling. Use your gifts to serve others. We are stewards of God's blessing. Stewards. We are meant to hold on to God's blessing. God's blessing doesn't belong to us. It belongs to God, and he's investing in us to do the work that he's laid out for us. So we're holding on to that blessing and then investing, using that blessing as God sees fit. We are stewards of God's blessing. And I know you may think I'm talking about money. I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about your gifts. I'm talking about your talents. I'm talking about your energy. I'm talking about your passion. I'm talking about your time. Time is a huge resource. It's 168 hours in the week. 168 hours. We're in church for one of them. What are you doing with the other 167 hours? I mean, yeah, you said, well, I work. Okay, that's a 40-hour work week. Well, I sleep. All right, 8 times 7. That's if you're sleeping 8 hours a day. If you are, holy cow, tell me how. All right, your time is an amazing resource. Invest your time. All these blessings, they never belong to us. We're just stewards over this blessing. God gives us what we need so that we can do the work of God. That's what we have. We are blessed to bless. It's this constant inhale-exhale relationship. Blessing is an investment into the kingdom from God so that we in turn can invest that into the kingdom and see growth. What about your gifts? See, as the Jesus community, we are the hands and feet of Jesus. We are the ones meant to do the work. Therefore, when we serve with God's strength. When we speak with God's will. Not our own. Not so that people can see us, but that so people can see him. And I have this routine every Sunday morning. And if you're in the worship team, you've heard me say something like this. And if you've heard me pray with them, sometimes you've kind of heard that. Or if you've just sat near me before a sermon. I have this kind of routine every single Sunday morning. Where I have to say, I have to remind myself, not my words, your words. Not my action. Not my life, your life. Or before worship, I'll often pray, you know, like, this doesn't rely on us. It's not on our shoulders. It's on your shoulders, God. We have the privilege of walking alongside you. You don't need us. We have the privilege of walking alongside your mission. Now, see, I have to pray that every single Sunday. Because, and I know this might surprise some of you, I have a bit of an ego. So I have to remind myself each week that it's not about me. And that has kind of a two-edged kind of sword there. On one hand, it's not about me, so it doesn't rest on my shoulders, so I shouldn't be stressed, I shouldn't be worried, because it's about God, and so therefore it's God's power, not mine. Everything is reliant on his amazing shoulders, and his strength, and his will, and his work, and that I can kind of release that burden and understand that what we do for him and by his power. But on the other hand, it also means it's also not for my glory. That at the end of the day, I don't want you to see me up here. I want you to hear the words of the Bible. I don't want you to follow me. I want you to follow God. Please, if you're coming here to follow me, check yourself, because I'm a messed up dude. Jesus is way better than I am. All right? But I have to have that routine, that prayer, every single week, because I need to remind myself too, that what we're doing, like, we're not doing it on our own strength. All right? We're not doing it on our own work, on our own skill, on my own wealth. We're doing it on God's blessing. God has given us everything that we need to have to be able to invest in the kingdom in the way that he wants us to invest it. So we rely on him. We trust him. We say, not my words, your words. Not my action, your action. Not my mission, it's your mission, and this is for you. So it has that question. Are you serving others, or are you simply content being served? Are you investing your life into what Jesus is doing? Or are you just riding the bus? Because guess what? As a Jesus follower, each and every one of us is called to drive the bus, not just ride it. It's our job to push mission forward, to drive mission forward, to be a part of the team. Volunteer in your community. Do park cleanups. There's tons of volunteer roles here at the church that you can give your time and your energy to. In fact, right now we need VBS leaders. So if you're free this summer and want to hang out with some kids, sign up on the wall over there. Tons of opportunities for you to serve that way. But it doesn't have to be here at church. Who needs right now? What needs do you see? What needs have you seen intersected in your life? How can you help? Sometimes you can't necessarily fix the problem. Sometimes it's just your presence. Sometimes it's just you're generous with your time and your ability to say, hey, I'm here for you. Sometimes all they need is a meal and you just invite them over for dinner. Sometimes they just need a friend. Sometimes it's not that simple and you need to truly invest your whole being into an issue. But seriously, do we have the attitude where we're seeing needs and addressing them? Or are we sitting back and waiting for things to happen? We also need to be generous with our relationships and even generous with our conflicts. We read about this in 2 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 24. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone. Able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. This one hits a little bit to myself. I like to argue. It's fun. That's okay. You can laugh. It's funny. I like to argue. But we're not meant to be argumentative. It says to be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Let me tell you something. No one was ever argued into the kingdom of God. No one was ever argued into heaven, no matter what. No one ever, ever came to the kingdom and was like, I got here because I lost an argument. It's not how that works, okay? So we are meant to be generous even in our conflicts. Even when people oppose you. Even when they belittle you or diminish you. Even when they are in your face getting aggressive, yelling at you 2 inches from your nose. You are meant to be generous with your conflicts. Our response should be generosity. Steadfast, gentle, loving generosity. Look, regardless about how you feel that the outside world looks, regardless of what is shared on social media, who's in the White House at the moment, regardless of whether or not you like the trajectory of our culture or not, regardless of who seems to hold the power, we know who really holds the power, right? Right? We know that God's the one in control. And we know, as Jesus followers, that he's already won the battle. God doesn't need us to defend him because he's already won. The church doesn't need us to defend it because we already won. We have other work to do. All right? Our goal is not to win. We've already done that. Our goal is to love. Our goal is to love. So let the opponents yell. Let people get in your face. We will meet that rage with calm generosity that comes from the assurance that it is finished. That Jesus already took care of sin. That Jesus already put in place the pieces to make the evil one fall. That we are already on the winning side. And we need to prove that to anybody. We just need to love people. We are called to be generous, even in our conflict. And then finally, yes, we are called to be generous in our finances. Proverbs 3:9 says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits. The Chicago mouth isn't liking that word. With the first fruits of all your crops. Yes, we are also called to invest our money and our wealth as well. Whatever wealth we have is an investment from God into the work that we're called to do in this world. So we are blessed so that we can bless others. This idea of first fruits is that idea that that first portion of the harvest bring in. And before even taking account in some cases, it's just saying everything I do, the first piece, before anybody else gets a piece, God gets a piece. The idea is that that first part of the harvest be given to the work of God so that we both, from our perspective, acknowledge that it comes from God, and also, too, so that we can advance the kingdom and the work of God. Now, I get it. Whenever I bring up this topic, I'm always super uncomfortable because I get it. The number one criticism of the church in today's day and age is that we just want your money. I hear it all the time. In fact, I remember I did a college visit years ago where I was answering questions from college students about ministry, and it was at a non-Christian college. And the question that pops out in my mind and that I, to this day, will never get out was, why do pastors be ballin'? If you know what that means, great. In other words, let me translate for you. Why are pastors flaunting their wealth? And it sticks in my head to this day, because I drove there in a beater tempo from the 80s that barely made it home. I think less than a week later, it was a cube. but that's the perception of the church. And so I get it. This idea that we just want your money is there. And it's not true, at least not here. Like, I don't actually know what you give to the church. I don't have access to that information. I don't want access to that information. We here at Whiting Christian Church protect that information, and I think rightly so, because I shouldn't see that, and I don't want to see that. But yes, at the end of the day, as a church, as any organization, we pay salaries, we buy equipment, we pay bills, we keep the lights on, just like any other organization. And in order to keep doing those things, we're reliant on your gifts and your donations. But giving our finances is about more than simply keeping the lights on at your local church. It's actually a healthy act of worship that's been shown in Scripture since the beginning. We're actually going to be doing a full study in what biblical giving looks like later this summer. And I encourage you to check that out. But this is a healthy act of worship. That by acknowledging God in what we have, we can also move the kingdom forward. In the local church, those gifts then fund ministry, outreach, mission trips, teaching, charity, and so much more. But my concern as your pastor is not that we have enough money to operate. Look, I believe that God is an amazing equipping God, and I believe we will have everything we need to do what he calls us to do. I have faith that that's going to happen. And that has been happening. As I look at the history of this church, God has always provided, and I expect him to keep providing. But my concern for you as a pastor is not that the church be rich. I don't care about that. My concern for you is that you embrace your full identity as a disciple of Christ and truly invest into the kingdom as you're called to invest. Look, I'll just be blunt with you. If you're a member here at Whiting Christian Church, and you feel uncomfortable giving to the church for some reason, I'd encourage you to chat with myself or chat with an elder and talk about that. We'd love to hear those concerns. And in the process, give somewhere, even if it's not here. All right? Because the act of giving, the act of your financial donations, is actually an act of worship. And it's vital to your own health as a Jesus follower, to be able to that posture of understanding that what God is doing and what God has given you is meant for the work of the church or the work of the kingdom, even if it's not this church. Right now, I'm more concerned with making sure that we are a generous community, that we each live lives of generosity that reflect the light of Jesus in every way, whether it be time, money, effort, whatever, than I am about the personal budget concerns of Whiting Christian Church. Because, frankly, my mission is to equip you guys to be the Jesus community. That's my mission. And the Jesus community is generous. So be generous. Be generous with your time. Be generous with your effort, your passion, your finances. Be generous as God is generous with us. Jesus modeled this at the Last Supper. John 13 says when he had finished washing their feet, he had washed their feet. And he put on his clothes and he returned to his place. He says, "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet." In other words, none of us are all that important, because even our Lord God, our teacher, our king, got down on his hands and knees and washed feet. So there should be nothing that we are unwilling to do because of pride. We have to love others, serve others, invest in others, invest in our kingdom, invest in our church, invest in the will of God like Jesus did. Jesus gave everything. Gave everything. Went to the cross for me. And he asks that I have that same posture when it comes to my neighbors and my community. So whose feet are you washing? Where are you investing into the work of Jesus? Are you driving the bus? Or are you riding it? Look, at the end of the day, I want to see revival in Western Iowa. I want to see Jesus move in huge ways. Anybody with me? Go ahead, you can raise your hand. You want to see revival in Western Iowa? You want to see the world change in crazy, awesome ways? You want to see God move and lives change? I want to see stories rewritten. I want to see every single person that I meet on the street understanding the same freedom and love and identity that I've come to see. And if you're waiting to see that, it's not going to happen if we sit on the sidelines and just watch. The people that are meant to bring about that change are us. The work that God has to do, the work that God has for us to do, starts with us, starts with you. How are you investing into the world? How are you investing into the mission of God? I want to see revival. And I'm going to work tirelessly to make sure it happens. And I ask you guys to join me on that. Not just by writing a check, but giving your time. I ask for your prayers. Spend some time every day and pray. Pray for revival in this area. Pray for God to move in amazing ways. I ask God for your effort. Pick up an extra box of cereal today and drop it in the bucket. Serve, give your time for VBS, or greet, or join our tech team, or maybe not even in the church, join the community club, pick up stuff in the park, start your own mission. The church, the ecclesia, are active. We're a movement, not a location. And so if we're going to be a movement, that means we have to actually move. We have to do. We have to act. We have to participate. We have to invest. God has work to do. It starts with you. Let's pray.